Let's start talking. Let's do that.
All right. Give me like your sexiest intro.
Hey, how you doing?
Okay, wait, say, I'm Alicia. I'm Alicia.
This is all bad.
No, it's good. It's good.
I'm on the ranch.
I'm on the ranch.
That's good. I'm on the ranch.
It's
Sam Elliott. And that hot, hot mustache. Hi, I'm Elisha Cuthbert, and I'm here on Faris' podcast, Unqualified.
So when did you move here? When did you move to Los Angeles? Because you're from Alberta.
Calgary, Alberta. We did a lot of moving around as a kid, though. I was born there, spent a little time in Vancouver, and then ended up going to high school in Montreal. I live even further east now in Prince Edward Island in the summer. So I'm all over Canada. But yeah, and then so moved to California at 18. See, here's the thing. I didn't want to go to college. I was scared of school. I hated
school. Don't blame you.
Yeah. Super dyslexic as a kid.
Yeah.
Still dyslexic. You can't really get rid of it. But I've found ways to kind of make it work for me.
Right.
But that was later on. Cut to Alicia in school, terrified. Liked acting, was doing some fun stuff up in Canada, did a great fun kids show there that kept me busy for 3 years through high school, and I realized, this is what I want to do. I think I could be good at it. I enjoy it. And my dad always said, you know, find something you love. I went, I found something I love.
So they were always supportive.
I think they thought I was a bit crazy, because I think they thought, no, wait, this isn't going to be your profession. Is it? Like, to me, I think they thought it was kind of like, oh, some kids take soccer. Some are in karate. She's in, like, little acting school. But I was working. It was just this weird thing of, like, when you're a baby, when you're a kid, you don't, like, equate that to, like, your whole life.
Right.
Especially for parents growing up in Canada and not ever sort of seeing that fruition happen. My dad's an engineer. My mom worked in a veterinarian's office, you know, real middle upper class, you know, family, suburbs. And here I was like, I want to go to California. And I was 11. That was weird. It was a weird thing to say.
No. I think it's kind of amazing. But here's what I want to hear about. Mm. Because when I moved here to Los Angeles, and I'm way older than you, but I felt like I was always losing jobs to you.
What?
And women don't get to act with one another all that frequently. No. But I
like
always
what? Like the girl next door?
You.
Did you all go in for that?
Yep.
Okay. 24. Yeah. You know, Isla Fisher came up to me once and was like, "Man, I wanted the girl next door.
Yeah,
damn you, girl."
And you're
but
so.
But you
kind
of got
good.
It with like you it had your version of it.
A little less sexy.
No, but, well, it was still very much that kind of vibe.
But do you have actress friends?
I wish I could say I.
I mean,
lot.
We have kids, so
that's
we,
tough.
Yeah,
I have actor or actress friends that have kids,
right?
That keep us actually closer.
I hope that it's changing, but I do think that those early 2000 years when we were all down here, that it felt like,
yeah.
Oh man, we.
I wish it was more of a community.
Yeah,
yeah.
Like the
you know
boys
who used
had...
to be. Remember who used to be, and you probably know this. Who was the best? Was Brittany Murphy?
Yes.
Wasn't
yes,
she
was.
Always
yes.
the bomb when you yes. go to an audition? She'd be like, "What's up?" And I'd be like, "How does she have this much swag? Always so caring. Always
yeah.
so." Do you remember her
yes.
like that?
Oh yeah, completely.
In auditions. And I'd be like, "God, that's what I want to be like."
I know. Yeah. No, you're completely right.
Actually, after that was imagine I like you said going back to coming here at 18 years old. You have to remember in Canada when I was working, there was only me and one other girl, and she was a brunette. So either you like the blonde or the brunette.
Right.
I was scoring 50% of the time. It was amazing.
Maybe then I would go with like 80. I bet.
but yeah, I remember being like, "Oh, dude, this is great. I love this. Acting's awesome." So cut to. Get here in California my first week, my first audition, and I was so pumped. I get in there, I'm looking around, I'm like, whoa, this is not me and a brunette. This is me and like seven other girls. And I'm like, okay, I'm all right. It's okay. I can hang.
Did you get it? I bet you got it. I bet you fucking got it.
No, didn't get that. Then I got another audition the next day. This was back when like there was, I feel like there was
auditions all the time
every
back then.
Second. Right? I had like three a day.
I know. And you
I had to like
know, for
plan
me, I
my shit.
Thomas Guide.
Yes. We had the same experience. But then I had to realize I was like, oh, there's another six girls and they were not the same as yesterday. So now we're at 12 and then 24. And then it was like, I started realizing really quick what am I doing here? How many episodes are you guys on?
Well, it's our seventh season.
It goes by in a flash. As stressful as it is, or no?
Oh, no. No, it is.
We've done 80. And I'm like, what? I feel like I've done 10, but of like pure panic.
You're so nuanced, really funny, in such a difficult format, I think.
Tell me what you think about it, about the format.
The format is, it's deceptively difficult, don't you think?
Oh, it's like sheer panic every, well, what days are your live show?
Our live show is,
because ours was Friday.
Yeah. And you guys had live audiences.
Oh, yeah. And a hype guy.
And a hype guy, yeah.
Make some noise.
Yep.
Boots in the fur. Oh, boy. We haven't actually told the people at home what we're even talking about. We're talking about the sitcom format. Four cameras in front of a live studio audience. That's where I kind of figured out I could be funny.
You're so fucking good.
I didn't think I got funny until like second season.
Oh, my God.
Oh,
no,
that's so
I think you're wrong.
Really?
Yes. Yeah.
I was just, that was my real
hysterical from get-go.
Oh, I'm so glad you said that. That was such like a actor's class of like funny for me.
Oh,
like I learned so much shit.
Fucking great show. And you're the heart.
Oh, that's so cool that you said that. Comedy is so fun. I mean, I know we always talk about how hard it is because it is. It can be technical, but you have to also not try. And there's so many, you know, you hear all these comedic things getting thrown around that you have to listen to and abide by and you can't steal shit. You know, there's a bunch of stuff. But I'm like, man, when you hit it, is there nothing better and when you hit it? It's like crack. I don't know what crack is like, but I feel like it'd be like that.
The way that you absorb these dudes.
You're doing a lot of set. Yeah, I'm setting up a lot of great punchlines for them, of course.
Exactly.
But I think that job is much as much.
Oh my God, it's so fucking hard.
It's so hard, but it's also so crucial to the progression of the episode. And if we really break it down, because a lot of people who are watching are not seeing that technical aspect of it, nor should they. But if you're sitting at home and wondering, like, what does it take to be a funny actor, I think like the first, if you can listen and like set that up and listen, it's one
what
of
do
those,
you mean
like I mean just like be she's
I'm
like
the
literally
dick.
Doing
I'm
that
the dick.
No, but I'm like if you're like if you could just listen and really listen, half your job's done. And then the other stuff you got to kind of work on and make sure that it's funny. And
but it is tough because watching The Ranch and
like
seeing
my thing
you,
is like reaction.
Yes.
That's my
you
jam.
You are an amazing reactor.
That's my jam. That I feel like that's my thing.
And you're like, you're an emotional reactor, which
well,
is
I
incredible.
Thank you. I feel like I try to do different. It depends on the scene.
Like that episode where you and Ashton's character, you guys are like recognizing that you're getting divorced.
Right.
And you are so like, yep,
just
you've
deflated.
Already decided.
I just love the stuff that isn't said. I don't like things that are wordy. I mean, I'll do wordy, like Gilmore Girls, but you know, whatever. There's an art to that too. But there's so much interesting stuff hidden in the shit that's not said and in the eyes and in your body language and in your shrugged shoulders and in your
right
or in your like you know like that upbeat like shoulders up high you know or if you believe it in your mind I think it comes across if you're really believing what you're saying and doing and you know this because you're amazing but I think that like that's where I like that little sweet spot I like the reaction I like physical comedy so much. Don't always get to do it. Happy endings, I got to do it. But man, just being a goof, I love that.
I do too.
I just like having fun.
Okay, wait. We'll get off work for a second.
Yeah, let's go.
Just for a second.
Yeah. So
I know that you have a baby.
I have a baby.
That okay, but changed. We don't want to talk about that stuff. Okay. You can talk about it if you'd like. Okay, what did it change? Your life.
Everything. It was like earth shaking. And groundbreaking. It was like heavy. Heavy and crazy. Being pregnant was not fun.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not going to sit here and be like, oh, that was such a great time.
Did you vomit?
By the way, I did not vomit and it was still hard, okay?
Yeah.
I did not Amy Schumer any of it.
Yeah.
And it was still hard.
Yeah.
Like, I don't even know how she got through that.
I don't know either.
But I'll never forget, we were on set at the ranch and Dax Shepard's on our show and his beautiful wife, Kristen, comes to set with their two beautiful kids. She was like, isn't being pregnant amazing? And I felt bad because I wanted to be like, hell no.
I know.
But there's a lot of women that are like, oh, I know. It was so beautiful and so glorious. And I think it was still very, it's very, it was very taxing.
And the idea of like the societal pressure of like, so are we supposed to, as women, we carry the baby and then we do all the other things. And
yeah, I only had 2 months off. I had 2 months of maternity leave. I worked up until I was about seven months pregnant and then came back like, literally, she was a month and a half or so and went back to work.
Oh, my gosh.
It was really intense. But during even my maternity leave, the ranch called and was like, you think maybe we could do some, like, FaceTime scenes? And I was like, you know what? I'm a team player. It didn't actually bother me. I was like, I was feeling good. I was like, okay, if it's just not going to be my face, no problem. So I think I'm, like, doing a great job here. And I got Ashton on the other end of, like, the iPad and we're doing the scene and all of a sudden I look down and like my whole shirt is
soaking,
soaking wet. I'm leaking like a mother, literally like a mother. That's where it comes from. That expression, like a mother. And I'm like, oh, did he see that? Have they seen that? I looked at, I'm like, hopefully they just saw my face. No one said anything to this day. I have no idea if Ashton caught on, but I'm like, okay, my whole shirt is drenched. So that was the first time I'd ever experienced like a letdown where she wasn't around. She must have been crying in the background or something. I don't know what happened. And all of a sudden I looked down and holy moly.
Okay, I know that you're married.
I am.
But imagine that you're not.
So imagine. Okay, yeah. Do the imaginary single vibe.
Yeah.
You got it.
Okay. I'm going to throw some things out to you.
Yeah.
All right.
You got it.
Okay. He drives an orange Hummer.
Like keep him or get rid of him?
Like you're single.
I'm not great at parking, so I don't know if it's a deal breaker, but I think it's like a serious conversation about that. Environmentally alone, I mean, you know what? It's a no-go.
It's a no-go. Okay. Okay. He's a Wiccan. He tells you, I only practice white magic. My black magic days are behind me.
I'm intrigued. No, I'm not. That's a deal breaker. I'm not. Listen, I like normal, chill, boring. Let's say boring. I'm not into any of this wacky stuff.
I was thinking about this question.
It sounds exhausting.
Exactly.
That's what I'm saying.
I was thinking about like how I could do a role play with you, and then I was feeling tired.
Right? It's just pure exhaustion. Yeah. I'm too tired for that kind of guy.
Too tired. Yeah. Yeah.
I got enough shit going on.
Yeah.
You know what would be good? First date conversation. Fascinating. But but then I'm tired after that.
Yeah.
Thanks for the company. Thanks for the steak dinner.
Yeah.
Have a great one.
Does he pay? Does the Wiccan pay?
Probably not. That's a hard no.
Okay. He tells you the first movie he ever masturbated to was The Girl Next Door.
You mean my husband? No. I don't know if that's a deal breaker. I think that's, I mean.
I feel like that's like after you're engaged or something.
Yeah,
like
you make a joke.
Well, and then there's like truth to it. It's like, but I really
gotta tell you something. And you're like, oh, thank God it was that. Nothing else. Oh, jeez. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Mm-hmm. He invented Axe body spray.
I like it. Entrepreneur.
Yeah.
I'm into it.
Yeah. Okay, good. All right.
Yeah.
He's a UFC fighter.
Oof. That's a tough one. Not a deal breaker. I'd like to know what his personality is like.
Oh, he's super cool. He's awesome.
Oh, no, it's not a deal breaker.
Yeah.
As long as he doesn't take that home and he can leave it in the ring. In the cage, as they say.
In the cage. Okay.
Leave it in the cage. If he can keep it in the cage.
Yeah.
It's not a deal breaker.
Okay. All right. Okay. He buys you a 1 month anniversary gift.
A 1 month? Because I was there like, I'm a big gift giver. That's like I like to do that. I'm not like, oh, I want all these gifts, but that is something like, if I find something or see something that I, you know, reminds me of someone, I'll like, I like to do that.
Yeah.
But let's hear what it is.
It's Dove deodorant.
Oh boy.
It's like,
he's telling me.
It's like the spring fresh scent.
First
it's
of
new.
All,
it's new.
That
it's a new
is adorable.
Scent.
That is the sweetest thing I've ever heard. He's a keeper. I like it.
Or it's a razor.
That's scary. No one tells me when to shave, damn it.
Or it's just like baby powder for, you know, no reason.
Random.
What might be a deal breaker for you? I know I'm really putting you on the spot.
No, number one, can't run a barbecue. If you can't barbecue, you're out.
Okay.
I know that sounds really aggressive,
like
the way
gas,
I said it. I kind of
like
came
a,
in hot with it. Like,
yeah,
but yeah.
No, but I need like a man you thought about it. All right,
I need
right.
a man
yeah,
that can yeah. can handle right. a barbecue because
yeah.
I cannot. So I need you to bring that to the table.
And you, yeah, all right. All
I
right.
feel like I deserve that.
Yeah.
I've worked hard in my life. I want, you know, I need a partner that can do a good steak or a good, you know, don't dry out the chicken kind of thing. And then I think that's really important for dudes to have a good relationship with their moms.
That's nice.
Listen, every story is different. I would be like, what's family like? And if they're like, oh, my mother's a shithead.
Right.
I'd be like, oof.
Wait, I felt like you were about to say cunt.
Well, I could say that too, but choice of words, I guess. I said shithead,
no,
you said
no.
cunt.
Well, listen, I
same
just...
Same thing.
I'm just, you know.
You know. You're just more hardcore than me.
Well...
Yeah, you
okay, wait. What is a song from 19... I'm going to go with 1999 that you remember.
No, because okay. guess what? My... You know what frightens me? My memory. What? My memory.
Okay.
Not good. 1999, all right. I mean, was Return of the Mac one? Or is that earlier or later?
I
can't get my bearings on things like that.
I know. I hate those kinds of questions. I'm sorry.
No, I'll give you all the kind of songs I love, but I'm like, I can't pinpoint the time period. Was it like NSYNC, Bye Bye Bye? Was that 1999 or was that 2001?
I don't know.
Like, I can't tell you.
Yeah, I think it was a little later.
Right.
Okay, wait. Okay, Alicia.
Yeah.
We'll get off this because I was thinking... One of two things.
Yeah.
Do you feel like doing an improv? Okay. And
like
you,
really
you
can, doing an improv? Like,
yeah.
Like characters?
Well,
I'm now, I have full back sweat.
No,
you just said improv and my back
you get
is
to be
sweating.
Yourself. You get to be yourself.
Oh, I get to be myself?
Yeah. We're on a red carpet.
Oh. And now am I being like me in a, am I being a nice version of me? Am I being like an exaggerated version of myself? Or am I being truly me? You just want me uncomfortable in how I'm going to handle myself?
Yeah.
I got you. Bring it.
Okay. Oh.
What am I like promoting? Am I like Premiere of the Ranch?
You're at the Premiere of the Ranch.
Okay.
This is All is right. it is it the final season?
Let's pretend it is.
Okay. Oh my gosh, you guys. I cannot believe it. I am here with Elisha Cuthbert. Hi,
Hi.
Alicia. It's Beige. It's so great to see you again.
Oh, yes, right.
I'm Beige McKenna-Smith.
Hi.
Oh my God. It's so great to see you. You look stunning tonight. You look
so
good.
So
oh, thank you.
Who are you wearing? Are we allowed to say that anymore? We don't talk about that.
No.
Okay.
But how excited are you to be here tonight?
I'm... Over the moon. It's been a really long journey.
And tell me about your husband.
Oh.
He plays hockey,
yes.
right?
Yes.
Yeah, well, okay.
He's sweet.
He's
really
oh, good.
Sweet.
He's good.
Sweet.
Did you guys skate together?
Absolutely
In the
not.
Winter?
Oh. Absolutely
oh,
not.
Oh, that's
no.
so great.
He's the skater.
Oh,
I'm
that's
the actor.
That's wonderful. Well, so, and then you also have a baby.
I
that's
have a
amazing.
The best thing in my life.
Oh, isn't that incredible?
The greatest thing that's
Fertility.
Ever happened to me.
Oh,
the easiest
oh,
thing ever.
Oh, my gosh. Now, tell
loved
me about
being pregnant, by the way.
Oh, yes. Don't we? Yeah.
It was
do.
So easy.
Okay. So wait, don't tell me. Now, what will you miss the most about not being a part of the ranch anymore?
Oh, what will I miss the most? I think just the camaraderie of all the castmates.
Oh, my God. Oh my god, I see Ashton.
Pardon me.
Okay, so we got. Oh go yeah. On.
Did
yeah.
you want to meet him?
No,
I'm sure.
Oh my god, no, he's coming over here. Okay, but no, we had camaraderie.
Yes, all the the people and how they all, you know, we all gelled. All the party every Friday was like wonderful. A party. Yeah, we did a lot of like, you know, drinking and having a good time. Oh, I'm gonna miss them. I'm gonna miss their families and their
kids.
That's
great. Oh my gosh, Ashton is heading our way.
Yes, he is. Here he comes. Beige he's so tall. The worst. He's so tall.
I think that this was a different beige, actually, than I've played.
Oh, really?
Before. Yeah. She's even worse than
she's I great. She I love be. Her energy.
Oh.
Oh, my God.
Okay, so is there any way you could give a shout out? All I need you to say is
tell
like.
Me. Yeah, I know this. I hear you.
All I need you to say is, hey, everyone.
I'm
Elisha
Cuthbert. I got you.
Okay. Please check out my interview on the red carpet.
Got it.
I got it.
Okay. Oh, here we go. Hi, guys. It's Elisha Cuthbert on the red carpet at the finale episode of The Ranch. Hope you enjoy. Bye.
Okay, but we needed
Bye.
To shoot there.
Bye.
Bye. That was amazing. Bye. Okay, but I would love it.
I'm going to go now.
Okay. Yeah, I know. I know.
Where's my publicist? Where's Dom?
I know.
Dom.
I'm awful. Dom. I'm awful. I know. Okay.
They always make you say the longest thing, like, and you have to memorize it. I loved that you did that because I'm telling you, it's the exact, and I'm just like, what's up? It's me. See ya.
And the worst part is that I feel like we can't complain. We are so lucky.
I know, but it's just silly stuff. I know. We can talk about the silly.
And then I feel like people are so disappointed when I don't get the lines quite right.
Well, they can be disappointed. I just think it's silly. It's okay to laugh at it.
Okay, friendship.
We're not sitting here going, oh, this is hell. We're just like, this is the reality of it. It's ridiculously silly.
Okay, but here's three more questions that we're getting to callers. Okay. Friendship deal breakers.
Oh.
She spends a night and borrows your underwear without asking.
Not a deal breaker.
Yeah, I agree with you. Okay, she starts a shared Instagram account for you too.
That's not a deal breaker.
Really?
No.
She uses your name to get reservations for herself.
Not a deal breaker.
Okay. She gets you an anal bleaching certificate for your birthday.
Don't think I'm going to use it, but it's not a deal breaker.
Oh, could be helpful. Maybe that's when's your birthday? Because I already sort of got you a gift.
I would die laughing. I love that. Definitely not a deal breaker.
She always calls you when she needs a ride from the airport.
Not a deal breaker because I'd just be like, bitch, don't call me again for an airport pickup.
Okay. All right.
That's all I'm saying. I would tell it like it is.
Yeah.
I'd be like, listen, this is the last time. Call our other friend. I have a kid. I have a 2-year-old.
She borrows your car, gets a ticket in it, and you don't find out until it comes out in the mail.
That's not a deal breaker either.
Really?
No.
She doesn't tell you?
But I'm mapping out the scenarios of me going, hey, Jenny, I got a ticket and this was yours. And she goes, shit, you know what? I was on the way to work. I was stressed out. I'd be like, whatever.
Yeah.
Not a deal breaker.
Yeah. All right.
No. You know what a deal breaker is, though? Because you wanted the deal breaker with the guys. Yeah, I'll tell you what the deal breaker is for the friend. Because there's not many, but blowing me off. Like, if I go, hey, let's go to dinner. Like, you could, like, blow me off one night. But then if you promise to, like, see me the next night and you blow me off again, and then you blow me off again, because I've, like, it takes a lot as parent, you know, as a parent, and with your own life going on.
Who the fuck is blowing you off?
I recently had someone in my life blow me off, like, 3 times in a row, and I went, nah, I'm done. And I just went, I can't do this anymore. Because it really just, the ripple effect of that is so jarring for me in a way that I'm like, clearly my friendship is not really worth your time and you're just blowing smoke up my ass at this point. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, you're on the phone with me going, oh, I'd love to go to that with you. Oh my God, that'd be amazing. Sorry, I can't make it 2 hours before, but let's do dinner. Okay, when? Friday. All right. Oh, babe, I'm sorry. I can't go tonight. I got busy. Girl, how many times?
There is a weirdly specific heartbreak with female friendships, I think.
And I was like, I thought we were tight. And I'm like, I just wouldn't do that. I wouldn't, one time, 2 times, but then it was like the third strike.
Yeah.
And I was like, this is just taking up too much mental space.
Every time you blow me off, you're breaking my heart.
Yes. Especially, like, you have a small kid. It's like you want
to... I'm making a really big effort to have you in my life. Because I really could count my close ones on one hand. No joke. I'm not sitting here in Hollywood going, I'm friends with everybody. I literally have five that I love and I dig and I put a lot of time into it. And they mean the world to me. And then if you're not getting that back, you got to give up at some point. And you got to go, you got to let that go. Let that ship sail.
Completely.
Otherwise, you're just heartbroken.
That's why I don't have any friends.
I wouldn't ditch you three times in a row. I promise you. I'd either tell you I can't go right up, straight up. I'd say I can't make it. I would never go, I'll be there. And then an hour before, do you do this? Am I literally describing you? You know what? I'd understand that that's the friend you are with me. And I have to come and see you. I wouldn't be like, hey, come to this thing with me. I would never put you in that predicament. You got to know your friends, too. You got to know.
That's true.
You got to know your friends.
Yeah, that's true.
This is a friend.
Thank you.
But this is a friend that...
just don't want you to expect a lot out of me.
No, not at all. That's the thing. You got to feel it out. Got to, you know, understand who your friends are. But this one in particular, I was really bummed out about. So that's a game changer.
I'm sorry.
That's a deal breaker. Sorry, not a game changer.
Yeah, but no, but I'm sorry. I think that most of us have been through friendship disappointments.
But here's the thing. I'm committing to it, too, by the way. Like, when I'm done, I'm done. Aren't you that way, too? A lot of females are like that.
Well, usually.
Okay. So you have a little gray area?
Yeah. Yeah, because I think with a little bit of time, you know, a year or two.
Yeah, this is still fresh.
Yeah, exactly. So if you're still thinking about this person in a year, then it might be...
something to contemplate again.
Yeah, yeah. I think, like, yeah. Right. Yeah. And I bet this person misses you. But
I don't even think this. I don't even think this person has even thought twice about me.
I think you're wrong. But I do think that you should never operate out of too much guilt in that way at all.
So I
think it's just like, do you actually miss this person's company?
No.
And then, like, okay, good.
No.
All right.
No.
Okay.
All right. That was dark.
This episode of Unqualified is brought to you in part by Best Fiends. We all know there really is only one match three style game worth playing. It's the one with an actual storyline, cool collectible characters, and nonstop action-packed adventure. It's the one with literally thousands of challenging puzzles to solve. And yes, I'm using the word literally correctly. Of course, I'm talking about Best Fiends. You meet your best fiends early in their careers. They don't have much experience, but they have heart. I recognized a little piece of myself in each of them. And so I began to assemble the perfect team. I watched them grow as we solved puzzle after puzzle, working hard and playing hard. Today, my best fiends are ready to go anytime and anywhere. I'm really proud of what they have become. With new challenges and levels added all the time, there's never a boring moment. So download Best Fiends free today on the App Store or Google Play. That's friends without the R, Best Fiends. This episode of Unqualified is brought to you in part by The Pill Club. Do you need to renew your birth control prescription? Want to switch your birth control? Maybe try it for the first time. Whether you know the brand you want or you're looking for help finding the best option, The Pill Club medical team has your back. With the Pill Club, you'll never have to make a trip to the doctor or wait in line at the pharmacy. The Pill Club is a birth control subscription prescribed by a medical professional and delivered straight to your door for free in discreet packaging. The Pill Club carries over 120 FDA-approved brands. Most brands of birth control are free with insurance or Medicaid. Otherwise, prices start as low as $7 per month without insurance. Right now, when you go to thepillclub.com/unqualified, The Pill Club is offering a $10 donation to bedsider.org for every unqualified listener who becomes a patient. Your donation will help low-income individuals get access to birth control through bedsider.org. That's thepillclub.com/unqualified to get your first birth control care package. That's thepillclub.com/unqualified to get your first birth control care package and donate to help more women in need of affordable birth control. Remember, thepillclub.com/unqualified. You must use the link to make a donation.
She was so cute.
Would you tell me a story? Okay, can I give you three options?
I'm terrified right now.
Okay.
Okay.
Tell me a story.
Okay.
All right. Here are your three options.
Okay. I'm being very honest with you too. This is.
I love this. I love it.
I'm like telling you how scared I am.
I love it.
Okay, go ahead.
Normally
I'd be like, bring it, girl. What do you got for me? Terrified. Go ahead.
Okay. Three options.
Yeah.
One.
Tell you a story about
your senior prom. Two.
Didn't go. Go ahead.
Okay, fine. Then now I have to come up with something.
No, no. Actually, that's a lie. I lied. Okay, go again. Give me the other options. Okay. Sorry.
The other options are the worst way you were ever broken up with.
Oh.
Okay.
okay. Never. No, I'm kidding.
Probably not.
No, I have. No, 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 no. That is that. No, that was a joke. I have definitely been broken up with. Go ahead.
Okay.
You don't want to say it. You don't want to say the last one.
Well, I really want to go.
You're afraid I'm going to be hurt.
No,
the I prom just, one is cool. Here's, you want to hear a little bit of
prom? Yeah, okay. Yeah.
So I was working a lot in Canada and I didn't go to school a lot. I was like tutored and like homeschooled in a way, but I would always like check in. I dated the same guy from my first year of high school all the way until my very last, he dumped me. Okay.
What?
So I was with the same.
Why did he dump you?
I don't know. That's a long time ago. You'd have to ask him. No, you know what? Truthfully,
what
I think
dick.
he was a year older than me.
He
went to college, right? And I had one more year left. So I get it. Over the summer, he broke up with me. He's like, I got to experience my college. I can't be with a high school student. You know how it goes.
Uh-huh.
Whatever. I was heartbroken. Yeah. So you know what? This is two of your stories in one, okay?
Yeah, this guy.
Broken up with over the summer.
My first guy real, that, like, kills you. Yeah. We should have been together.
He was really my first love. And he, we had a great high school run until he broke up with me the summer of,
isn't that the worst?
99?
Like
summer
was that,
99?
Like, was that your first heartbreak?
Oh, yeah. Cries. Had the cries. Ugh. Yeah, sure. Sure. That's normal. You know, I said a friend of mine.
It should happen to everybody.
I have a daughter, right? And she's only two. And I was speaking to a friend of mine who has two daughters. And I said, you know, I'm so excited to have a daughter, but man, I'm not looking forward to that first heartbreak. And he goes, why? I said, because I know what it was like. It was really rough. And he goes, better to be loved than never at all. I'd rather my daughters come home heartbroken than not. I went, all right, fine. But anyway, so he broke up with me.
I bet he is not going to feel that way when it actually happens. He's going to be like,
I know, you know what?
Let me come back and tell you how it goes.
He'd be like, this is not going well.
Let's check back in 15 years.
He had this like positive spin on it. And I'm like, dude, it's going to be hell.
Yeah.
It's so upsetting. It's so hurtful.
Yeah.
But it's life.
It's life. It's an important journey.
It's an important journey. So I go through all of high school with this one guy, great guy, breaks up with me. I come back kind of like, you know, head down, senior year, prom year, really.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, we get to the end of the year, and it's going to be prom time. And all these guys want to ask me out.
Oh.
I'm finally single. I went four years with a guy.
Damn.
I had no idea I was such a catch.
Oh,
I had no idea
God.
That anyway, everyone, all these boys, like, were interested in me. I was like, I was like, bye, buddy. I'm cool.
Hey, you guys, Alicia's single. Like, she's fucking single now. It's so fucking rad.
No, it was wild. I got a lot of sweet, sweet offers
hey,
on it.
Alicia, what's up?
What's up?
Well, I'm trying to be a dude that's asking you
to prom. Oh, and what I did? Okay, I'll tell you.
I'm going to go with Brad.
Go with Brad. Oof, yeah, go with Brad.
Hey, what's up, Alicia?
Hi.
Hey, what's up? Hi. So, I know that... I'm super fucking sorry that like I heard about the breakup and shit, man.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
It's all right. It's okay.
Yeah, but
it was hard this summer, but I'm fine.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that. That fucking sucks. Yeah.
Saw your basketball game last weekend. You did really good.
Oh, thanks. Yeah.
Boys did great.
Yeah, I just broke up with Becca, so.
Mm-mm. No.
So anyway, I know that.
Sorry, I'm just having an apple.
That's cool. No, you're healthy. It's cool. But anyway, I know that like junior prom's coming up.
Are you okay? Is everything all right?
Yeah, well, I'm just like I'm fucking, my heart's a little broken because Lindsay
also
like dumped my ass.
I should talk to her. Is she okay?
Yeah, she's cool. She's kind of a cunt, but it's cool.
Don't say that about her. That's not nice.
Nah, it's not that nice. But anyway, I was just wondering if there's any...
You know what? Anyway, can I think about it?
I haven't even asked you yet.
I feel like I know what you're talking about. I feel like I get what you're saying. Just spit it out already, Brad. I don't have time for this shit. I gotta be at social studies in like 2 seconds.
God. All right. Well, I've always really liked you, and like just wondering if there's any way you could, you'd want to maybe go to prom with me. I don't know.
Honestly, I feel like I couldn't do that to Cheryl.
Oh my God. What?
Is that her name?
No.
Shit. What's her name?
I can't remember.
Damn it.
It's definitely whatever, not Cheryl.
I know. I couldn't think of anything else. Was it Janet?
So wait, your loyalty is towards that girl?
Yeah.
Not towards me?
No. Oh, I feel bad for her, and I do not want to step on anyone's toes. Here's the thing. What ended up happening...
You're not going to prom with me.
Definitely not. End scene. So, what ended up happening was... I say this like... I made it sound like 100 guys asked me out. Not the case. I had a couple guys who I was like, wow, I had no idea that they were even interested. And at the end, it just didn't feel right because I wasn't dating any of them. And I went, you know what? I'm going to go with a really good friend. So I went with this guy named Ian, who I was really good friends with. And we just went as friends.
Poor Ian.
I know.
He's in love with you.
No.
He's so in love with you.
Oh, that's ridiculous.
He's like, oh my God. No, no.
No, no.
Hey, Ian, wherever you are, will you please, please call us?
Hit me up on Instagram.
Yeah. I mean, she's married. No, she has
you know
a baby.
What? I gotta say, I had such great guy friends in high school. We had so much fun, and girlfriends as well. I remember coming home one time, telling my mom, "I wish you could experience what I'm experiencing right now, because it's kind of the best time of my life." I didn't know that I was gonna have much better times, but it was so much fun for me, and I had such a good time. The one thing I do remember though is people, the guys, being like, man, you're like one of the, you're so cool. You're like one of the dudes, or you're like one of the guys. And I was like, I always felt like, wow, that was such a compliment. But in this like Me Too movement, I realized I'm like, what if I was cool? I couldn't be a girl. Like I couldn't be like, man, you're just cool. I had to be one of the guys. Another version of that thing where I think if like you have a friend in high school or elementary and she's a woman and you're a dude, just because she's cool doesn't mean, you know, she's got to be, like, dude-like. It's just, you get along, and it's working, and, you know. It was just another one of those titles that we give. And guys get those titles, too. It's just, like, I remember thinking, yeah, I'm, like, one of the dudes. I'm, like, cool.
That was such an identity.
Right?
That was such,
Because I got along with everyone. It was such a badge. I got along with dudes. I got along with the girls. I got along with, like, the gothic kids. I got along with the artsy students, the jocks, everyone. But when you were with the dudes... and you could hang, you were like one of the dudes. Yeah. But really, I was just me.
Yeah.
Anyway, that got deep.
Depressing. No, but you're completely right.
You know what I mean? It's just one of those stereotypes.
Because it's not, because it's not like
a bunch of girls. Or like if a boy is like, being or acting weak or emotional, it's like, right. Don't be a pussy.
Right.
Don't be a little, you know. No, he has emotions too that are just as valid as women's emotions.
And you, like, as a group of girls, they're like... Yeah, hey, you're one of the girls. Yeah, this is fucking rad. You're, like, actually one of the girls. Like, that would not be perceived as a compliment.
No, he'd be like, what? Clutches pearls. What?
Oh, yeah. I do want to hear your social media thing.
Yeah, let's go. Let me talk to you about a little social media.
Okay.
No, you know what? When we were talking earlier about how I love the apples... It's actually really satisfying. The sound in my headphones right now is really good. I think that's why Brad Pitt's always eating in every scene, because it's like there's something about someone. Yeah, it's good. I like it. I get the choice now. Before I was like, oh, he's just hungry a lot. But no, there's something very sexual about it. There's something very sexual about it.
Thank you. I thought it was maybe disgusting.
No, it's fantastic. No, but you know, we were talking about like auditioning back in the day and doing this and doing that. Don't you find publicity has changed? In that one, first of all, social media, which is a whole other conversation, but this is leading to it, that now social media has made publicity so much harder for actors because we have to be creatively doing all our own publicity in a way. And what used to be like a photo shoot, you ever get this where you get an email going, you got any art you can send over? I'm like, bitch, where's the photo shoot? I'm not a photographer and a costume designer and a, you know, I'm not. What? Do I have any art? I was like, yeah, just take a nice like selfie and send it over and you could be like in the top hot 100 of, you know. I'm like, no, I don't. Or you do an interview and they send you an email of 10 questions and you got to type your answers. And I'm going, my grammar is horrific. I can't send my answers to whatever. I can't even think of them. Do magazines even exist?
There's this industry that's like built off of, and it cannot be anything that I can fucking complain about.
I feel like we are allowed to, for lack of a better word, rap about how it used to be and how the changing of the guard has happened and how even in the last 20 years, there's been such a shift because of social media that we can, the power that we can take into our own hands. But what if you're not great at it? You know what I'm saying?
I'm so bad
like,
at it.
That's my thing. I'm like, I would rather, like, I had TV Guide be like, hey, we'd like to talk to you about the ranch or whatever it was. Maybe it was happening. I don't know. And they're going to send over an email, 10 questions. Can you write them out? And then we'll print. I'm like, I've got to be now the journalist. I was like, what? That like freaked me out. We used to do like real phone interviews and we used to do like sit down. I'd meet a journalist in a coffee shop. Do you remember that? Like going to like Chibo's. That's what you would do. You would like go over and sit down and whether they hated you or not. I mean, that would reflect in the article, but like literally there was some sort of dialogue. And now it's because of social media, journalists are like, why do I have to do this? Like you're doing it yourself, you know?
Yeah.
That's what I do miss. I do miss that sort of old school, but that's just me being like, wow, it used to be so different. I guess we can navigate how much we want to be in, how much we want to be out.
You're so right, though.
Oh my God, it's changed so much. I'm not saying it's good or bad. I just miss some of that.
This episode of Unqualified is brought to you in part by Intuit, powering products like TurboTax, QuickBooks, Mint, and Credit Karma. Intuit works for what you work for, and it was only recently that I found out they were working for me. I've been using QuickBooks for years, and more recently began using Mint, which is an easy way to create monthly budgets. It was a bit surprising to realize how much I could save by learning how to make coffee. With Intuit, artificial intelligence can predict your future cash flow, recognize a misplaced digit in an account or routing number, and even connect users with live experts who can assist with navigating life changes or help with unique tax situations. Everything is automatically organized as you track your personal or business expenses by scanning receipts, invoices, and other financial documents, while smart budgeting tools let you know before you overspend. Innovative features like these make managing your finances simple, but as you probably already knew, innovation is at the core of everything Intuit does. Discover how Intuit's products can help you see what's possible at Intuit.com. That's Intuit.com. This episode is brought to you in part by Plant Botanical. As everyone slowly comes out of hiding, many of you are asking the same questions. Am I ready for actual human contact? Should I swipe right? Will they look like their picture? Do I look like my picture? Is that the face of an axe murderer? Do I really want to take off these sweats? And for those of you who get that far, what drink should I be casually sipping? I have the answer to that one. While your date sits awkwardly silent, stunned by your good looks, dazzled by your intellect, or wondering how to dispose of your body, the drink in your hand should be delicious, refreshing, crisp, clean, Plant Botanical Vodka Seltzer. weighing in at only one carb, made with real fruit and botanicals traditionally used for stamina, immunity, and detox, Plant Botanical is already thinking about your future encounters. Follow and DM at Plant Loves You and share a story or video of your funniest, wildest, or most awkward date for a chance to win up to $1,000 for your next one. Plant Botanical, your perfect companion while you look for your perfect companion. Available at Target, Pavilions, Vons, Total Wine, or visit plantlovesyou.com to find a store near you. Plant Vodka and Vodka Seltzer. Just the good shit.
So now we're going to talk with our callers, and these are the questions that they sent in.
Are we doing Kayla first?
Hello?
Hey, is this Kayla?
Yeah.
Hey, Kayla, it's Anna, and I'm here with Elisha Cuthbert.
Hi.
Hi, I'm so excited.
Oh, my gosh. I'm reading over your email, and I'm like, this is heavy.
Wait,
but like,
Kayla, yeah,
Tell us what your thoughts are here.
So I am happily married,
yeah.
I guess. I've been married for 2 years, and I've been with my husband for 6 years. But sometimes I'll be like, oh, this is really great. We're having a great time. And I'm like, you know what would sound greater? Being divorced.
Right.
And it's kind of weird. I'm like, oh, man, that sounds really dark. Maybe you should get out of that headspace. But I'm also kind of nervous because I'm like, if I feel that way, am I like a terrible person? And is
no.
there something more going on?
No.
No.
Okay, wait,
no. How old is your son?
Yes, my son's 4.
Kayla, can I ask you a couple of questions? What you're expressing, I think, is something that a lot of people go through. So
yeah.
I know, I feel like we're going to get a lot of feedback about this. But can I ask you, what do you think you're missing? Is it sort of like world adventure? Is it more love? Is it like hot sex? Like,
you know, I don't really know sometimes. Like,
yeah.
We're like very much the like picture perfect marriage.
Kayla,
like,
when you think about that thought, does it throw you off? Like when it pops into your head, do you go, God, why did I just think that?
Yes.
Yeah.
And then like, I think like, oh, I would love to, I want to go do stuff and I want to travel and like,
yeah.
I want to go out and get a coffee and not have to worry about like,
yes.
anything.
Listen,
does that make sense?
Yes.
100%.
I don't even think you have to, honestly, but Anna, you might have a different opinion about this, but I honestly think I wouldn't take this too heavy. I mean, I wouldn't go deeper in, I wouldn't go down like a rabbit hole of like despair on this and be like, I need to get a divorce. I think you're human. I think you have a 4-year-old son and it's a lot of work. And navigating, right? And then guys, as much as guys can be hands-on, you as a mom, nothing can replace that sort of thing where you got to be constantly aware of the little minutia, like you're dealing with all the little details and not to put down your husband, but like that's going on in your head, right? So my thing is like that panic and that overwhelming mountain of responsibility. And then that overwhelming mountain of, I'm never going to have anyone else in my life except this dude. All the gravity of that, totally normal.
Like, oh, thank God.
Right? It's all good, girl.
Yes.
If you feel like the first, you know what's crazy? You got on the call and you're like, I feel like I have the perfect picture, perfect marriage. You know what? Anna asked you, what do you think it is? And you were like, honestly, I think it's just that like human nature thing. Like it's just normal.
I hope so. Cause it is like, we're very, you know, very like typical. He works all day and I work all day and we have like a good house and nice things. But it's like, sometimes I think it would be so much easier to just be alone and not be married and not have all this stuff to deal with. And I don't know. Like it's
Fuck.
A lot. I'm
Kayla.
The primary parent too, you know, like
you
how
go.
Moms always get sucked into that primary
yep.
parent role.
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Let's think about like some practical ideas here. So you do love your husband.
Oh yeah. I love him very much. Like that's not an issue. And like, we do have like awesome sex But like, yep. It's like we're also like glorified roommates sometimes. Most of the time, being honest.
That's marriage too. I mean, you're into 8 years together. I mean, listen, marriage is not like always roses and butterflies. And this is just me. I mean, you tell me what you think.
Kayla,
but
are you guys in a position where you could potentially take a road trip?
Yes. Yes. Take a break second.
I wish we were. The last time we went on a date, I can't even remember.
It was a long time ago.
Our
the last time
are considered like going to our friends' weddings and like
watching Dateline and like can't even get through the full episode without falling asleep.
Yes.
Yeah, I know what you're. Yeah,
we watched Dave Chappelle the other night, and that was it.
But you know what? That sounds glorious to me. I would say. Try to find some of the beauty in that, too, because I think a lot of married couples are doing this. This is what they're doing. And this is like kind of beautiful, too, right? It's you got a lot of responsibility, girl. And then having a son and being the primary person dealing with that other person. Do you know that you're giving 80% of your day to another human being and not really getting a whole lot back? But you are in the long run. You're doing a good job. It's good. And I think it's normal.
But wait,
oh, good.
Kayla, I do want to ask you, though, like, can you guys take a road trip, like, in the next, I don't know, 4 or 5 weeks? I don't know if you can take that time off of work.
That's a really good suggestion.
I don't know. I would love it, but my husband's, like, one of those, like, old school guys where he thinks washing the car is a big grand gesture of romance. So, like, I sometimes don't even know how to start with him and like the things that I like to do and things that I would plan. Like, I would love to go do that. But then like, I'm so worried he's gonna be like, why are we doing this? Or we could have used the money for something else. Or you know what I mean?
Yeah, I do. Okay. Could you guys take off time and I could fund it?
What?
That would be so crazy. Amazing.
I'd probably pass out if that really
Kayla,
happened.
I would love to like give you guys a trip someplace, but I just need to know if your husband will be down with it.
Could they do a weekend?
Yeah, I was thinking about getting them.
Like, we've never taken like a vacation longer than a weekend. He's a weekend warrior. Like, we can do 2 or 3 days and then he's like, okay, I'm done with this.
Well, then a weekend sounds reasonable. That's exactly what they need. Yeah,
they need
a mom break. You need a moment away from your son and just be wife again, you know, for 1 second.
But Kayla, do you think that your husband would be into this idea? Like, if you guys went down to Florida, like,
oh, yeah,
or New Orleans or like wherever, I don't know if you have family that can take care of your son or if you want to take him with you or you know.
I never know what's going on in his head because he's very much the quiet guy, like the strong, quiet type, I guess. So
he needs a break, too.
It does.
Sounds like he needs a hot second.
Okay, Kayla, here's what we're going to do. We are going to fund a vacation for you guys.
Oh, my God. I'm going to cry.
But make sure, here's the only thing. I just want you to make sure that your husband is down with it. You know,
I think he would be very down with it.
Awesome. Yay.
And I would suggest if your family is around that they take care of your son.
Yes.
So it's just the two of you.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. I could work that out.
Yes. And use that time to reconnect.
Okay, Kayla. All right. We're going to be in touch. But here's the only thing, though. Will you promise to send us a couple of pics? We won't have to post them, but we just want maybe a couple of pics.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. And then we'll get like, you guys can give us your dates that would be, you know.
Wow.
We'll work on all the things.
Look at you, Kayla.
Oh my gosh, this is crazy. This is so awesome. Crazy.
Kayla, I do think that that you guys just need like a minute, you know?
Yeah.
And
so it's not like me like trying to sabotage my favorite picture or anything like that.
Girl, you're tired, man. You're just like, this is a lot. This is like This is the responsibilities that we discover when we become, you know, spouses and then become ultimately parents. And it's heavy. And these thoughts come into your head and they're totally normal. Doesn't mean they have to be factual. It's just human nature. Of course, it would be easier if you didn't have to deal with, you know, a husband who's a workaholic and a son who needs your undivided attention. So, of course, you're feeling that intense pressure, and it's totally normal. But this is going to be amazing.
Yeah, girl! Okay, listen. Michael Sherman, my assistant and my dear friend, is going to be in touch with you.
Yes.
And then, though, afterwards, like, let us know how things go.
Yeah.
And let us know if
like,
your husband.
But what do I do? Because like even when we go on a date, sometimes I'm like, I don't know what to say to you.
Don't make it too heavy. Don't make it too heavy. Don't try to bring up major things. You know, go and enjoy yourself and kind of erase your mind of a lot of the pressures. Don't let it get clouded with what should we do about preschool? What should we do about next year? What should we do about? Let all that go and just go back.
Just
to...
Just show your boobies.
And do that. No, you know what? And don't put a lot of pressure on it. Just try and go and have a good time. That's all. Just go experience where you're at.
Okay.
And if this grand experiment doesn't work,
right,
then you are not at all at fault for questioning any of these things. I mean, you're young. You have a young child. So if things don't work, then that is not on you or him necessarily, but give it a whirl. Let's see what happens. And then, you know, and please be in touch. And Michael Sherman is going to be in touch with you.
It's just weird because like there's nothing bad in our marriage. Right. It's just like,
you're just a little bored.
But sometimes boredom is good. I mean, I think it's just a lot of stress and a lot of stuff to deal with, you know? And it would just be a lot easier if we didn't have all those things.
You're wise.
Wouldn't it be?
Yeah.
But you know what? That's not life.
Okay, Kayla, you have to... Here's the condition, though. So Michael Sherman's going to be in touch with you, but I really would love, if you don't mind... We don't have to talk about this publicly too much, at least if you don't want to, but I would love to hear how everything's going.
Yeah.
Yes. Absolutely.
All right. Cool. All right. So he's going to be in touch with you.
I love you guys.
So, I love you, too. Awesome. I love you, too.
It'll be fun. Cool.
That sounds awesome.
Yay! Okay. Thanks, Kayla!
Bye, Kayla.
Well, thank you. Hello?
Hi, Lindsay!
Hi!
Hi, it's Anna Faris, and I'm here with Elisha Cuthbert.
Hi!
Hi, you guys. Hello. Thanks so much for calling me.
Yay. Oh, thank you so much for being a part of this crazy journey.
Oh, hell yeah, Anna. I love the show. I've been listening for a long time. It's gotten me through so many nights working really long by myself. It's hilarious. It brings so much joy. I love it.
Oh, that means the world to me. Thank you so much. Thank you. And I'm so happy to be back, and I so appreciate you reaching out to us. And tell us what's going on so we can give you horrible advice.
So I have been with my hubby for like 10 years, married for like 3 or 4 now. And a couple years ago, I started a job working with horses, which has like always been a passion of mine. It was a hobby of mine as a kid. I grew up with them like at home and stuff. So it was really exciting to have an opportunity to like turn my passion or my hobby into my job. And when I first started, you know, we were both really focused on our careers. We were working a lot of hours. So all the negative aspects of the job didn't seem to matter as much. But now we have a baby who's a year old now, and we're talking about having another one. And there's just aspects of my job that make it really, really hard. And I know that my husband really hates it.
What does he do? Sorry, it's Alicia. What does he do?
He works in in marketing, and he's so supportive. Like
is his job does he have a lot of hours like you do?
He does. His job's a lot more family oriented. Like he works a lot, but he can take a sick day, take a mental health day, work from home.
Yeah.
It's definitely a more 9-to-5 culture.
Right.
He doesn't always work 9-to-5 for sure. He's a super hard worker, but he just has a lot more flexibility. You know, being in a farming industry, you work 6, sometimes 7 days a week.
Yeah.
Your shortest day is a 12-hour day. There's no such thing as a sick day. And like since having a kid and now we put her in daycare when she turned a year old, I've been sick like all the time. Because, you know, they're gross.
How did you
like,
find a daycare? Oh, no, it's preschool that doesn't take them if they're not potty trained. So it's a daycare she's going to. Or is it he? Okay.
It's daycare, yeah.
Okay, I got you.
And this, you just don't have those things. And I mean, it's a man's world. So there's a lot of misogyny. I'm the only girl that works there. So you get like snide comments. I guess a lot like the entertainment industry, it's a type of job where it's hard work, but it's also really talent-based. So you get some weird personalities
right.
who are really, really talented, but, you know, they've gotten super far on their talent and their hard work, not for being nice people.
Lindsay, I don't mean to cut you off, but I have a couple questions. So it seems to me like you love your job, right?
I do. Yeah.
And
I
then,
do.
But
I
then your husband doesn't love
that she's gone.
Your job.
Yeah. He doesn't love the parts of it. Like, I think if my job were more like, oh, you're sick, take a day off. Oh, your kid needs to be picked up from daycare. No big deal. Head on out. We'll see you tomorrow. He wouldn't hate it as much.
Right. Okay. So, but Lindsay, I'm just wondering why your husband is threatened by your job that you love.
I don't think he's necessarily, because it wasn't like a problem for us when we didn't have a kid. But now that there's like this other little being that requires so much of us and so much in general, when I'm working like these 7-day, 6-day work weeks, like it all falls on him. And he's working too, because like I don't make a lot of money, you know, like I can't keep our house afloat financially.
So he doesn't think it's maybe worth as much time that you're committing to it because it's not bringing in as much as it could or should if you were doing something that maybe paid you more for that time.
Yeah. And just like the little aspects of like respect, like I think he worries about my health a lot because I do work myself crazy and then I get sick and then, you know, because again, kids are
stress.
Like disgusting and sick all the time.
Yeah.
And I can't take a day and I work anyway and I work and I work until I'm like really sick. And it really bothers him that there's a culture that you just keep working till you're dead, basically.
Yeah, that's hard. Especially with a 1-year-old.
Yeah, and like, you know, I do the nighttime stuff, which is not at all a thing on him. It's just like breastfeeding. It makes more sense. It's faster.
Do you have to do this? Do you have to be doing all this? Or is it just,
no,
it's purely just a passion, right?
Yeah, I don't. And I mean, we've talked about it too. And he's like, well, what if, you know, if I wasn't working, is that something we want to do?
He suggested that?
He totally has.
Okay.
He has. Yeah.
Okay.
So it's not like he's like, you shouldn't be working. You're a lady. It's not, it's nothing like that.
Right. No. Right. Right.
He's woke, you guys. But it's really hard on me, like physically and mentally. And then because it takes so much, like my job takes so much of me, I feel like he doesn't get the pieces of me. You know, he gets like what's left over and my daughter gets what's left over.
Sure.
And I think it's just like frustrating for him and for her probably. And it's just like, you know, I don't know.
Maybe
we do want to have another kid. You know, I want to have my cake and eat it.
This might seem easier said than done, but just go with me.
Yeah.
Is there a way that you could just put it on hold and revisit it, like your passion, like in a year or two, to see where you guys land? Is that crazy? And I'm not saying because I don't think you should follow your passion, or some things just have a time and place. And if you feel like you're getting pulled in a million different directions with your husband and your son and your work, is there a way that, I don't know, you could put it on hold? If not, then maybe we can keep talking. I don't know. This is tough.
So that's like technically an option. And we kind of talked about like, what if I did part time and stuff, but I think also, and I don't want to like shut that down, like it's not an option because it is, but it does potentially, I don't know that it does mean this, but it potentially means limiting like my trajectory, because I've only been in this industry for like,
so you're climbing years. You're climbing right now is what you're telling us.
Yeah, like I'm working really hard, and like there's not a lot of ladder to climb, but it takes a lot of again talent, and I'm like honing my talent through daily practice, and like people who've made it, they can work a couple days a week, they can, you know, do this show one year and not the next year because like whatever, they don't want to. But I have not by any means made it, you know, I'm like, I'm starting my journey. So the thing that scares me is that if I go part-time or kind of put it on hold, that just means that it won't be a career. It'll just be a job. If that makes sense.
Well, oh boy. Oh man, this is a lot, Lindsay. I mean, and I love it that you called us for this. So here are my initial thoughts.
Yeah. I want to hear what you think.
Well, first of all, I love horses as well. I really do.
I'm terrified, but go ahead.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Yeah, I'm scared.
I love them. So I'm scared too, but I love them so much.
Oh, no, yeah. I don't dislike a horse, but...
We have some really nice ones if you guys want to come ride sometime.
Yes, I would love
I don't dislike the species, but I am nervous. I'm a little nervous. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah, they're big. They're huge. They're huge.
They're big animals, but beautiful. Anyway, majestic, really.
So... I think that examining like the idea of your husband hating your job and hating what you're doing and what you love is like a little bit of a thing. But having said that, there's resolution in this potentially.
Yeah, for sure there is.
I don't want to like give the wrong impression. Like he does not hate that
I figured.
I'm like working with horses.
Yeah. It doesn't seem
like, and like pursuing something amazing. He
yeah.
Hates that, like,
well, the fact that he's willing to give up his own, maybe pursue that.
Yeah.
Like if he's totally into maybe taking a breather and picking up the slack and letting you take this trajectory to the top of your business, that's a that's a good place to start. Like, oh, babe, are you serious about this? Because this could be really a game changer for us. Like, because the only thing when I see this and I hear this story for me, I'm like, is that someone's got to take a second and like give it a breather, right? Like someone's got to give up something. Totally. You guys are all doing too much. Someone's got to give something and then go back to it. Doesn't mean forever. Mm-hmm. You don't have to commit to like never touching a horse again. You can like, you know, or he doesn't have to give up, you know, doing his thing forever, right?
Yeah.
I don't know. What do you think?
I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about in general, but, but I just know how I felt being with a fella for, you know, 7 years, my first marriage, and then...
Not feeling like, supported
with
your job, and it makes it hell.
Yeah.
It makes it real hell.
Yeah.
You can't do it unless you're supported.
Yeah, but also, though, it wasn't even so much that. It was like, what am I looking for as well? Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. Like, I can't blame it
all on
him. Well,
and that's the other part of it. Like, so this has always been a hobby and, like, a passion and stuff. And even at the top of the ladder, like, it won't make a whole lot. So it would mean, like, a lifestyle change for us because my husband does make more than I do. Which, again, he's chill about. He's like, let's, you know, sell everything and live in a tiny home or whatever. Like, he doesn't care. He's like, whatever we want to do to make our lives happy is great. But it's that thing where it's like, if we have another kid and I keep working as much as I am, is it something that I can even sustain? And is it like worth making him change his whole life and trajectory and everything for me to like walk down this road and find out I can't do it? And then, so there's like the self-doubt aspect of it. And then it's just, I don't know. It's like, it's a dangerous industry itself. So having kids also makes me worry about that because I work with young horses, like not to make you guys more scared of horses. They're great. You should ride them. but you know, like young ones, they don't know anything about people. Like to them, you're scary. They don't get it. So there's like a lot of high risk there, like for my physical well-being. Which again is something that I take on, but like when you have kids, you rethink these things and it's like, part of it's like,
is it worth making us reevaluate like our full life and making him rethink it so that I can do this and maybe find out I just physically can't work that hard that often? Or is it a soul searching thing that I just like don't know what I want and I feel like I'm at a crossroads?
Here's what I think you should do. I think that you are at a crossroads, as we all are, kind of, most of us at least. And I think that it could be that your profession agitates your husband because...
how physical it is on her and
yeah,
how hard it is on her.
Yeah, and also that you're not, like, your passion is more towards horses as opposed to him.
Oh, that's interesting.
You know, like, you might need to ride him. You might need
to. Yeah, I mean, I would definitely.
Yeah. You gotta ride your man.
You
can
do it.
Jump on it. Let's do it.
I mean, especially if we're talking about making another one, like, you know, we'll get cooking.
Yeah.
But I think deep down, you sound like you're, first of all, you're very articulate. You know exactly how you're feeling. That's not lost on you. So I think if you keep soul searching that, like Anna said, and just kind of zero in on what you think is most important, if it's having another baby, maybe taking a step back, maybe him taking a step back, think about those three things and see which one fits. See which one fits and go with it and then call us back and let us know if it worked out.
Lindsay, hey, thank you so much.
Thanks, Lindsay.
Thank you guys so much again. I'm so glad you're back. I was listening to your like 2016 podcast last week because I was by myself at work. And the artwork changed, and I was like, oh, my gosh, what's going on? I'm just so excited to have your podcast back in my life.
Oh, that means the world to me. Thank you so much. I love you.
No, it's brought me so much joy. I mean, I was listening to, like, the Natasha Leggero Moshe Kesher episode by myself at work, and you and Natasha just finished your old Danny, like, exchange. And I walked around the corner, and a very confused and disturbed vendor was standing there. Not sure what was going on. Thought I was alone. Did not have headphones in. But I think I got you a new fan by explaining that it was just a podcast. It's really funny.
Thank you.
I wasn't watching porn at work.
Lindsay, thank you. I love you. Please keep in touch.
Thank you guys so much.
I was like 13. We went on this road trip and I would look at the fields like through Montana and I would be like, oh God, if I only had a horse. I was just like imagining myself like running through those fields with a horse. It was like could match the speed of our minivan.
Oh my God.
And it was like
so beautiful. What a vision.
It was like the Astro van.
Yes.
Wait, Alicia, this is our final goodbye.
Oh, doesn't have to be. I would do this shit weekly. I'll come back anytime you want me. I'm telling you, that was a blast. That was so much fun.
You gave amazing advice.
Oh, I was just like, I don't know. Really?
You did.
And you got a thing for horses.
I sure do.
Not me.
What?
Not me.
I thought you were going to go horseback riding.
Not a chance.
Alicia, I love you so much.
I love you. We should have done this sooner.
Hey, dear listeners, if you would be so generous, would you tell us the story of your worst date and we will read or play it on the podcast? Please write down or record your stories and send them to anna@unqualified.com. Or you can send a letter or postcard to Unqualified P.O. Box 528-15332 Antioch Street. That's spelled A-N-T-I-O-C-H Pacific Palisades, California 90 272.